What was the focus of 2016 and 2017 when we were talking about blockchain? Everybody was talking about ICO, right? And that came and that went extremely up and down. And now is everybody talking about STOs, the security token offices, really the security tokens, real bonds, real shares, and also authorized by the authorities. So Marleen Evers, can you come up? Where's Marleen? Can Marleen come up? Oh, there she's all totally in the back. She is a very brave woman. She is basically having an exchange, start an exchange, where companies like Fastnet could go public much easier than in the normal world. And she's really working on this whole next phase to make it very easy to do all the securities on her exchange. So, but you are the new way of doing things. So I'm very excited to have you here on stage. So give her a big hand and good luck.
Thank you, Vincent. Wow, so today I'm going to share a little bit about Nextchange, of course. Quite some people in this room probably already heard my story about Nextchange, my journey, how to get there. But today I'm trying to go a bit more into practicalities, like how can we really use Nextchange? And not within 10 years from now, but now already. So just to give a little bit about my background, I'm Marleen Everts. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Nextchange. I have a background in derivatives trading, and 10 years ago I started with digitizing assets. And I started with gold because gold is closest to the financial world. It's very easy to identify and to trade ownership on a distance. And by now, we trade on an annual basis between 7 and 8 billion in value in gold, not only by ourselves, but by white labeling our platform to third parties in the world. And in 2016, I was approached by Fastnet, company with a huge community, and they said, like, can we not use your platform for trading securities? And I thought, wow, this is my chance to get back into the capital markets. So I went to the regulator and said, we need to trade securities, we need to raise capital with our platform, so I need a permit, and let's go for the highest in rank. We would like to have the regulated market permit. And the regulated market permit is on the same level as what Euronext has, what Deutsche Börse has, what any exchange in Europe has. And we got it. And we got it for one main reason. On a relatively quick throughput time, because we settled transactions 24/7, real-time, DVP, because that was what we were used to in our trading gold world. And we went live with Fastnet, and well, I've done a lot of entrepreneurship, but this was the first time where everything went according to book. Fastnet was funded within a couple of weeks. The community started supporting Fastnet. Fastnet has been listed for 2.5 years. The share price of Fastnet has been really stable over those 2 years. It's always been around 10. And even when Fastnet went through difficult times, the share price stayed around 10. The community of Fastnet really supported Fastnet. And if you look at the median of Fastnet, the median of the investment portfolio of the Fastnet investor, it's around 1,000-1,500 euros. It's just really, really low, which is also interesting to witness. There are no market makers on Fastnet. On Euronext, there wouldn't have been a market maker on Fastnet either, most likely, because it's a very small fund. But the market, there was always an order book. As long as Fastnet has been listed on an exchange, there has been an order book, and there were transactions on a daily basis. And the spreads might have been broad, but hey, there were transactions, and people were are able to get out if they like. And there's always an interest from buyers. So from that moment, we start thinking like, hey, we have a proof of concept. Sounds weird, because in fintech, there's no such thing as having a proof of concept. You need a platform, you need a permit, and hey, oh, it would be nice if you also have a customer. So we took it from there. We said, okay, now we have this exchange. It's there, and this was 2016, pre-ICOs, blockchain was sort of in its first developments in terms of technology. So we really thought, like, okay, we need an infrastructure, because if we want to make this scalable and want to make sure that this is going to take off on a huge level, we need the institutionals in. And we thought, like, how can we get to the most volume in the shortest amount of time? Because that's what it's all about. If you have an exchange, you need volume, you need transactions, you need investors, and not only retail investors, you need institutional investors as well. So we developed an exchange as a securities exchange as a service. Anyone, and not only Fastnet, not only a bank, not only an exchange, should be able to run an exchange. And a regulated exchange. We truly believe in regulations. There's a reason why law has developed in a certain way. So we developed an exchange as a platform, and a technical platform, combined with the permits, and we offer it to third parties. So And we don't believe that we are going to stay the only ones in this market. Definitely not. So you need to think about, like, operability. How do you get from one venue to the other? You need to think about, okay, which problems are we mostly resolving? And we started off with, okay, we want to have deal flow and we want to resolve a problem. So we approached our first partner, the Rabobank. And the Rabobank was immediately on. I've never seen a bank make a decision so fast. I think within a month and a half we had signed contracts, because the banks have a huge issue. With Basel IV, they cannot finance everything anymore. So they have to sell a lot of no's to their customers. And Rabobank said, okay, we want to use this exchange platform, and we build it from them. Took us longer to get our next set of permits, but hey, now we have almost all the exchange permits you can get in the world, because we're not only a regulated market anymore, we are also an MTF, we have our investment firm permits, and we went off in December. And next to Rabobank, there are in the whole of Europe, because our permit goes until the boundaries of Europe, there are now banks that say, like, hey, this is interesting. This is a new sort of way of funding. So there's a lot of interest from the banks. So we're speaking to banks in the Nordics, banks in Belgium, in France, in Germany. But there's another group that's very interested in our proposition. And those are the crypto markets. And next to Lieke, we are already talking to the second partner who is getting on board. And these crypto markets, they have this huge investor bases. And they have nice products, but they also see that they want to offer. So next to the cryptos, they would also like to offer traditional securities, ETFs, listed products that are already listed on the traditional exchanges, but tokenized. So it's two worlds. It's like old and new, and we're sort of with two legs in the middle, and sometimes I get a sort of an identity issue, but that's okay. So from there on, we're starting to continue. We're onboarding partners in the whole of Europe, and those partners issue list products, or they bring in partners that, issuers that list products. And everybody is able to access the exchange, regardless if they go to Rabobank.com or Lieke's app, Lieke's app-based, or the web environment from any partner. They can log in with the same login, see their portfolio, and do transactions. However, the products that are offered, the partner decides where they're offered. If they are only offered on Rabobank, or also on an exchange, if they are offered to the public or in the private market, but it's regulated. Wherever you go, wherever you are on exchange, you are on trading on a regulated, supervised market. So, and the nice thing, and that's probably the biggest thing and difference between exchange and a traditional exchange, is if you want to go to an exchange, you therefore not go to anexchange.com. Now you stay with the partner. And there's an important reason for that. There are a lot of technological developments, but people want to stay close to what they know and where they belong. And Therefore, we chose to build our platform within Rabobank. And Rabobank is now basically doing IPOs from out of their own site and running a secondary market. So we started the corporate financing from out of Rabobank. Rabobank is planning to list between 150 and 200 companies a year on an exchange. And they started really small. Bonds issued from 200,000 euros, which is nothing, but they're slowly building it up. But there's another category, sustainable finance. So important. There's a huge push from out of the European governments, and it's a no-brainer. There will be companies that need to be funded, and there are companies, other companies, that need green energy. And what about real estate? Real estate, we can list products so efficiently and cheaply right now. So why should we not list single assets, single buildings? So the future is now. I'm in the building of ABN and very grateful that they resolved one really important thing for us. An exchange is a very core platform, and the only thing we do is exchange things. And we tap into those places where assets belong. So we have connection to the CSD, where the securities are stored. But we also needed a solution for the store of value in terms of fiat money. So ABN AMRO Clearing has set up, we've developed a blockchain bank account with ABN AMRO Clearing, where customers that open accounts on an exchange basically also open accounts at ABN AMRO Clearing. And through a blockchain, we are able to settle transactions, to manage their portfolios, to be able to offer real-time settlement. And why is this interesting? Because once we're starting to tokenize products, and we want to connect payments to the capital markets, it's fantastic if you are in a framework. So here we are with ABN AMRO. What if we add the regulators and Euroclear to it? And if we add BUX, because they have announced last week with ABN that they're also in this framework. Hey, that is like a lot of investors that now can get access to an exchange to settle products. What if we add warehouses or ships, I just heard about, land registers, vaults, or even shops? Then we can trade everything for everything. And what does that mean? List your own solar panel, for example. Pay for your car with your shares. Sell your equity in your villa. Or pay for your coffee with your zero coupon bond. And this is possible now. We're not talking about the future. These are the products we are currently developing now. So that brings in something. And I'm almost finished, I see. I have 0 minutes left. You need to know your assets. That is becoming really relevant because there's an enormous amount of data heading our way. And those are the projects we're now working on, together with institutionals, together with parties that really know how to do this. And because in the future, you will need to be able to identify, you won't be investing in funds anymore. You will be creating your own funds. So you need to manage your risks instead of managing your assets. That's what you're going to do. So thank you very much. This is what we're building. I hope you can join me if you want to have. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me. And I believe that Vincent has some questions as well.
Yeah, well, the audience, thank you. What kind of technology are you using?
Well, our cash is tokenized. Yeah. We are currently in the process of tokenizing our securities. We already know how to do it. We already have tokenized our cash, so we also know what the technology behind it is. The cash system is based on Hyperledger. If we would tokenize our securities, very likely we would do that based on an ERC 1400 contract on Hyperledger, on D3. But Corda is also a very good option. But it basically depends on the what's going to be the token depository of the future,
Okay.
What the industry does.
Okay, so that's really important. How did you get approval from the regulator? Because this is really like a big gateway in, you know, of allowing assets to be tokenized, companies to go public, shares to be that normally I would expect that would be a very hard thing. I mean, these regulators are a pain in the butt, right? I mean, they're gonna be on stage in a couple of minutes. But how did you do that?
I don't know. Jumped through a lot of hula hoops and just built the technology in a way that it serves the law instead of going around the law.
Yeah. Well, I think there's more to that story. But okay. So let me see. If I can go public, right? I can have a company and I can basically sell shares.
Yeah,
right?
You can sell shares.
The real shares, and they're the same kind of shares as with the normal exchange, but what is the advantage if I do it with you? How much easier is it on your platform or on Rabo platform or on IBM's platform?
Well, to start with, you can sell shares from out of your own web environment. So you are a company X and you can do your IPO from out of your own website tomorrow, and you can run your secondary market from your own website. So your customers don't need to leave anymore. So suppose you are KLM,
yeah,
and you have this huge customer base. So why would you go somewhere else? Just raise your capital in your own community.
Yeah. It sounds too easy. It sounds too easy. And I can also take a building and basically divide it up in a million parts and have a million tokens and sell all the tokens, and people can share and sell these tokens among each other or through the exchange?
Absolutely.
And how expensive is that? How do you charge for it?
Well, we leave that up to the partners we collaborate with, but Rabobank charges 3% in a success fee for listing a company.
3%?
Yeah.
Okay.
But that is what Rabobank is charging, and yeah, we share our fees together with the partners we collaborate with.
Okay. Single point of trust. Is the ABN clearing, is that a single point of trust? Do we have to, is ABN, the reputation of ABN, basically making sure that you're successful and can be trusted?
No, absolutely not. So ABN is doing one. So we do everything on the platform, from onboarding issuers, onboarding investors, up until clearing, trading, and settlement. ABN is doing one thing. They look after the cash. Mm. So if you hold cash, if you hold euros on an exchange,
then
you have a counterparty risk against ABN AMRO ClearMaker.
Yeah. This is a difficult question. I have no idea what they mean. How do you solve the Oracle problem for assets?
Well,
the real Satoshi again.
Someone can explain that one to me.
Hmm?
The Oracle problem for assets. Well,
yes, external.
Yes. So yeah, that is what I try to explain. So we have the exchange platform, but we have oracles in place that confirm, independent oracles that confirm that those assets are really there. So we have ABN AMRO Clearing confirming that the money is really there. We have Euroclear confirming that the securities are really there. We have a vault operator confirming that that the bars are really there. And that is basically how everybody has a role in the system and has a certain function.
Okay. I'm going to stop it here.
Thank you.
Dave Bird says, you know, all that trade stuff, all these trillions and trillions of dollars, that's immaterial. You know, that basically could be done in another way. But this, as he pointed at you, this is the real shit. That's what he said. This is real. This is really changing. And last year he talked about tokenization economy. So did they listen well enough to you, Dave, that this is the future getting closer? Okay, give her a big hand. Marlene, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.